I will let. Good evening and welcome to the John F. Kennedy Jr. Forum. I'm Maggie Williams, Director of the Institute of Politics here at Harvard. Tonight's forum will consider a subject of great importance to democracy and global politics, and I think to the making of U.S. foreign policy. The IOP is fortunate to co-sponsor tonight's event, Hong Kong in Crisis, the Origins and Implications, with the Ash Center for Democratic Governance and Innovation and the Harvard Hong Kong Society. We are grateful to have Professor Anthony Saich as our moderator, and I will ask him to introduce our panelists after I tell you a little bit about him. Professor Saich is a leading internationalist, scholar, and expert on China who oversees an array of global works and projects of such great range and impact that it is hard in a short space to convey all that he does. But let me try this evening. As director of the Ash Center, Professor Saich oversees the Rajawali Foundation Institute for Asia and also serves as faculty chair of the China Public Policy Program, the Asia Energy Leaders Program, and the Leadership Transformation in Indonesia Program, all offering training projects to national and local Chinese officials. He is also the Daewoo Professor of International Affairs here at Harvard Kennedy School. He advises government, private, and nonprofit organizations that work in China and Asia. Here at Harvard, he sits on the executive committee of the John King Fairbanks Center for Chinese Studies and the Asia Center. He is also Harvard's representative to the Kennedy Memorial Trust, which provides scholarships to UK students for graduate studies at Harvard and MIT. We are very grateful that you are here tonight. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for that generous introduction. First of all, thank you everybody for attending this evening. It's clearly a very important topic. What I'd like to do is first make some general comments by way of introduction and then pose some questions to our panelists, and then we will discuss some of those issues and then open it up to questions from the floor, which is the normal practice. So just briefly, by way of introduction, the long-term background to this is that when sovereignty was granted to China from July 1st, 1997, it was under the principle of one country, two systems. That, of course, was unclear what that would really meant, but in principle, Hong Kong's economic and social system was to be continued for 50 years. The details, in as far as they exist, were then enunciated in the Basic Law, which was formally adopted by the National People's Congress on the 4th of April, 1990. However, I think the role of Hong Kong's right to interpret and amend the Basic Law was ambiguous, at least. And powers were vested in the National People's Congress and its Standing Committee to oversee those aspects. But of course, the key turning point and what has brought us here together this evening is what began to happen from June this year, when the State Council Information Office in China released a white paper to correct what it termed were misunderstandings about one country, two systems. And it said in that report, and I quote, "The high degree of autonomy is not full autonomy, nor a decentralized power. It is the power to run local affairs as authorized by the central leadership." And it seems to me that is important for the discussion that we have this evening. This was made even more clear in September when the National People's Congress announced its decision concerning universal suffrage for the election of the chief executive in 2017. As we know and has been reported in the press, the candidates would be selected through a small group, not the population of Hong Kong as a whole. And then the demonstration started. We've just got to the end of almost 2 months of demonstrations. There have been discussions between the Hong Kong government and representatives of the protests. The government offered to submit a report to Beijing. There was talk of maybe a referendum amongst people in Hong Kong, which has been postponed. Some have even called for direct talks with Beijing. So that brings us to this evening. So where are we at the current moment? And what are the possible options for the future? And it seems to me a set of questions arise related to that, and we're very lucky to have panelists who can speak to those issues. First of all, what is the actual legal status amid this set of complexities? Are people really talking on the basis of actual legal precedent? Is there clear laws laid down by this, and how can one interpret it? Also, it's interesting in that context, I think, to understand clearly how is that nominating committee put together, because I think there's also a misunderstanding about that. Secondly, a key issue is, will Beijing budge? My view is no, I don't think it will. Already we see a very traditional response from Beijing, blaming it on a small number of troublemakers, claiming that there's foreign involvement, which is stirring up troubles within Hong Kong, which is the normal response from the Chinese Communist Party to when there's unrest or when there are problems or demonstrations. Does it actually matter to Beijing? How important is this to Beijing? And then thirdly, as we enter the second month of this, what can the protesters do now? What are their actual objectives? As I said, we have three experts here who can help us deal with these questions and others that they arise. We have to Mr. CM Chen, who is currently a mid-career student here at the Hong Kong Kennedy School. He's a legal counsel in Hong Kong and also a member of the Hong Kong Society of Lawyers. Here we have Professor Kirby, who is a university distinguished service professor, has a wide-ranging knowledge of history throughout East Asia, teaches both at FAS and also at HBS. And also we have with us Heather Pickerell, who is due to graduate from the college in 2015, deeply knowledgeable about Hong Kong, quite aware of what has been discussed by the protesters. But let me turn first to Mr. Chen, because I think one of the key questions is trying to understand what the legal basis is here and what is the principle on which this nominating committee is put together. CM?
Thank you, Professor Saich. I would like perhaps to start with the very beginning. When Hong Kong was returned to China in 1997, it was actually based on the joint declaration between the government of the Great Britain and China, which was signed in 1984. It's a very long, extensive international treaty, which is actually registered at the United Nations. The most relevant section of that declaration is, for tonight's purposes, is about the chief executive. When British government and the Chinese government, they agree that when Hong Kong is to be returned, the chief executive will be chosen in the following way. Very broad terms, either by, it should be nominated by the central people's government on the results of either election or consultations. So in other words, the British actually did not promise that there will be universal suffrage in Hong Kong after 1997. So this is the starting off point I would like to make. And like Professor Saich said, in 1990, the basic law, which is Hong Kong's mini constitution, was promulgated. In the basic law, Article 45 actually elaborated a little bit. It sort of recited the terms of the joint declaration, and then it goes on to say that, yes, Hong Kong, you can have universal suffrage in an orderly manner, and also in accordance with the actual situation of Hong Kong. The ultimate aim is universal suffrage, but there will be a nominating committee to pre-select the candidates before the public can vote. So it's actually written very clearly in the Constitution. So we will talk about more about the composition of this nominating committee in a minute. But just by way of legal updates, the protesters are still on the streets as we speak. And there are actually two injunctions taken out last week against all these protesters. And the Hong Kong Bar Association and the Hong Kong Law Society both issued a statement condemning those encouraging people to disobey the injunction, which is granted by an independent judiciary. This is actually quite damaging to the Hong Kong rule of law. So you know, just by way of update on this of issues, because many people are actually affected in Hong Kong economically, but as a lawyer, I'm a bit worried about the encroachment on the rule of law, which is the backbone, cornerstone of Hong Kong's success.
Certainly that's something that always has been pointed out as being one of the keystones of life in Hong Kong, and as a number of people would say that, you know, even under the British, you know, Hong Kong had all the trappings of democracy without the actual elections, the rule of law, free press, so on and so forth. Heather, I just want to turn to you, given one thing that CM mentioned there, and that is that this was never promised. So why are the people protesting? They're protesting about something that was never promised to them, and yet it seems to be giving the impression that Beijing has somehow moved back from a promise it has made.
From my personal experience, I think people in my generation feel a certain sense of frustration with everything that's going on in Hong Kong. You know, the first thing I actually remember was watching The Handover on television, and it was a moment of great promise for our city. You know, we were being returned to the mainland, and Hong Kong was on a great path. You said it yourself, Hong Kong is all the trappings of a democratic country without the process of elections. And I could say pretty much until this year, I think many people my age actually didn't really have an opinion on the subject. I myself was neutral on the subject of democracy, and it wasn't really until this summer when the white paper was passed and the Chinese government decided that it would have a nominating committee. And then, of course, we all saw pictures of the tear gas on the streets and the pepper spray, and I think that was a key turning point for many people. A lot of people don't realize that the Occupy movement actually was a pretty small portion of society that didn't really have general consensus or backing. And I think this year was truly the turning point for a lot of young people in Hong Kong especially. I saw yesterday in a Chinese university report, 78% of Hong Kongers under the age of 30 now support the democracy movement. Mm. That definitely wasn't true even 4 or 5 months ago.
So how much then, Heather, do you think this is really, I mean, I understand there's a catalyst which has set this off, but how much, and you seem to imply this in your comment, that it really was an outpouring of other frustrations that were building up amongst people in Hong Kong as they observed this process of one country, two systems developing? Is that a fair statement?
Yes, I think it is a fair statement. There's a lot of, you know, underlying demographic and socioeconomic tensions that are emerging in Hong Kong. Whether it's political corruption has been a topic of discussion, social inequality, Hong Kong is the most unequal society in the world when it comes to socioeconomics. Those two especially are topics that are constantly under discussion in Hong Kong. Also, political freedoms has been a long topic of discussion since the handover. I remember when I was, 9 or 10, when nearly a million Hong Kongers took to the street to protest against Article 23, the largest protest of its kind in Asia ever. So, you know, these things have been long-standing issues, and I think they finally come to a helm now.
That's interesting. Bill, I just wanted to turn to you for a minute, because obviously what is behind all this is Beijing's attitude. And you've studied extensively Chinese history over a long period of time. And I suppose I have two different questions for you. The first is, how is this being seen in Beijing? And secondly, I know you've recently been in Taiwan. What is it? Is this having any effect on the way Taiwan is thinking about potential future reunification with the mainland?
Well, I'm just back from Beijing, and if you're watching TV, it isn't being seen in Beijing. The screen goes, blank. But of course, it is being watched very carefully by the leadership in Beijing. You know, if you look at it historically, it's a very interesting story. In some sense, Hong Kong's return to the mainland almost surely would have happened much earlier had there not been a communist revolution, or had they not won. Chiang Kai-shek would have taken this back about 1955, 1956. So one could say that the communists saved Hong Kong for capitalism, for the British, for some period of time, because it was quite useful to them at a moment in time.
Unless, of course, Chiang Kai-shek had allowed capitalism to flourish in Hong Kong, and then...
He might or might not have. But if we look at the... I think what Heather talked about is very interesting. The fuse for this was lit in several incidents in recent years, the one that Heather just referred to, but also 2 years ago, I believe, it's this Guomin Jiaoyu, the idea of a patriotic education coming from the mainland using mainland textbooks or textbooks based on mainland textbooks to make Hong Kong Chinese more patriotic, more learning party history and so on. And there was an enormous upsurge in the universities and in the high schools against this. Why did this happen? First of all, my sense is that the Beijing did not want an incident on this. And the Hong Kong government, perhaps trying too hard to please Beijing, pushed this very hard and came up against a very large backlash by people who are now educated in a great university system in Hong Kong, where there is full freedom of expression. Almost all who are in Hong Kong universities today are the first person in their family to go to universities. So you have a highly literate and upwardly mobile youth that have different aspirations from their families. And that gets me to kind of a big point, or I think it's an important point about the one country, two systems. Of those two systems, one of them is more or less the same as it was when this principle was announced or articulated. In many ways, it's become more authoritarian, that is the PRC system, since 1984. But Hong Kong has changed dramatically, as Taiwan has. So it's a formula that doesn't allow for the flexibility easily of the second system. And yet Hong Kong has evolved in a manner in which, in many ways, there's a more open discussion of public issues. There's more democracy today than there was in the last years of British rule. But it's one country, two systems has something that's half-baked. That is to say, only one side of it, is it clear what it is? And so you have a chief executive, no matter who it is, it's structural, a chief executive who has authority but very little legitimacy because of the way he's selected. You have a legislature that has legitimacy because it's elected in part, but virtually no authority except to block things. And then third, you have a superb permanent bureaucracy and legal system that is really the envy of the world, but it has no political base. And so I think you're seeing a political system in transition, but to what is unclear. And it's a very difficult system to make work even in and of itself, let alone vis-a-vis a larger and, at the moment, impatient mainland. Then what are the implications for Taiwan, which has changed dramatically since the one country, two systems principle was enunciated by Deng Xiaoping and is now a full-fledged democracy. I was with our Harvard Law School graduate, President Ma, in a meeting with him last week in Taipei. And he had just given in his Double Ten speech, that is to say the National Day speech of the Republic of China, the idea, quoting or playing on a quote from Deng Xiaoping, that who once said famously that some parts of China should get rich first. And he said, well, maybe some parts of China, greater China, should have democracy first. If I remember the phrase. For which he got a very unpleasant response from our friends. So this, the idea of one China, one country, two systems, the idea of one country may be stable, but the systems themselves are not.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I think one thing that struck me from both, Heather, something you mentioned and something Bill alluded to, if I was Xi Jinping, I would be furious in the moment.
At whom?
At whoever advises him from Hong Kong. He must have had such poor advice,
yes,
both from the Hong Kong government, but presumably from his own offices in the liaison office, the Communist Party offices, that must, and whether it's just because he talks to a certain elite within Hong Kong, it seems to me that Beijing was very ill-informed. I think all of us were ill-informed. I mean, I was taken aback that this particular set of demonstrations broke out. I mean, if I had been sitting in Zhongnanhai, which is the headquarters for the Communist Party, I wouldn't have known how to respond. So I think he probably has had very poor intelligence, and it's really put them on the back foot. But CM, I wanted to come back to one of the other issues with you, and because I think one of the really crucial issues this hinges on is this nominating committee. And it seems to me, if there is a way forward, that is perhaps one of the only areas where there may be a foot. If Beijing's not going to say, yeah, you can have open elections for the candidates. So I think it's important to understand, how is this nominating committee put together at the moment?
I think, Tony, you're absolutely right. The Hong Kong government actually issued a consultation paper last year asking for opinions how this committee should be made up. Unfortunately, the whole focus now turned to Occupy.
Right.
So people actually forgot about, you know, the most important point is actually get this committee as democratically represented as possible. So on the one hand, one extreme, the pro-democracy camp people say that this nominating committee itself should be one people, one vote, should be, you know, universal suffrage on this committee. I don't think Beijing will allow that.
Right.
However, on the other hand, on the other spectrum, the government seems to be proposing there should be made up of four different sectors, basically similar to the functional constituencies of the LegCo, which is the legislature of Hong Kong, should be elected. So basically it's made up of professionals, businessmen, people like that. So there's actually a big spectrum between that. And let's get down to business, talk about this committee. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we actually haven't started the process mm-hmm. yet. It's still in consultation.
Yeah. Heather, if we look forward from the protesters' perspective, is this maybe a more sensible area to focus on? Or, you know, from the people you know in Hong Kong, where do you see this going now after 2 months?
So I agree that it's probably the most sensible way out of this is to focus on the nominating committee. There's only so many concessions that you can get from the Chinese government, which in my personal opinion, and it looks like in yours, probably won't concede anything at all. But the thing is, what people don't really truly understand here is that the movement for democracy is actually very split up. It's a very nebulous blob that involves lawyers, politicians from the pan-democratic camp, students, the Occupy movement, and they all disagree on what the solution for a better democracy in Hong Kong is. And you can see that with the most recent announced that they were going to have a vote, a referendum on the government's suggestions, and then they canceled it. And I think that shows the divisions within the democracy camp. So while it's my personal opinion and the personal opinion of many of my friends in Hong Kong that focusing on getting a democratically, demographically, socioeconomically representative nominating committee is probably the best way to go, a lot of people in Hong Kong do think that the chief executive should just be one person, one vote, and that's it.
Hmm. So you think there should be more democratic centralism in the movement?
I mean, I think...
Among the students.
Among the students,
I mean, that's the thing. It's not so much amongst the students, but it's really... it looks like it's students versus the Occupy movement. They don't seem to look eye to eye on a lot of things, even the location of the protests or, you know, what the color should be. All these things are really disparate.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I think that's this is not an unusual phenomenon when you have a grassroots movement that comes up. And I think it's often one of the problems that... because it tries so desperately to be inclusive, it tries so hard to be different from what is there before. I mean, it tries to consult extensively. I mean, I saw this, you know, back in 1989, I was on the Tiananmen Square most days, and you could see that there were different groups with different agendas, and no one wanted to impose an agenda on anyone else. And part of the end result was, who do you negotiate with, under what circumstances, and what do they really want? And I suppose, you know, you seem to be making the argument that the divisions within the group in Hong Kong makes it difficult for them to come to a consensus themselves.
Absolutely.
It strikes me that there's also one dimension to this that I think is very difficult to study and to understand, but it's a cultural dimension that we're now, you know, X number of years since 1997. The mainland presence in Hong Kong is much greater.
Yeah.
In terms of mainlanders, successful mainlanders who have moved for excellent reasons to Hong Kong, which is a wonderful place to live and to bring up children. Real estate, of course, putting pressure on real estate, but also the cultural dimension of everyone now learning Putonghua.
Yeah.
Everyone standard now. Chinese. Finding alternative career paths, possibly in the mainland or not, kind of a denigration, just linguistically, of Cantonese and others, which is a much more ancient, and at least in poetry, more distinguished language than Mandarin. And it reminds me a little bit, happily it's not this tragic, of the tensions immediately in Taiwan after post-unification in 1945, 46, 47, where people were told, suddenly you will speak Mandarin, suddenly you will learn Sanminjui. Mm. So there's a cultural dimension to the 228 movement also, that incident, that is
so
really...
So you can say a little bit what the 228 is?
That is
I'm
to say
sure
an uprising everybody... against nationalist rule in the unification, in that moment after what one can think of as the first, who knows if it will be the only reunification of Taiwan with the mainland. The other thing is that I think it's attention that has to be, and perhaps Tony, you could talk about this, but there's, you have in the People's Republic a sense that what we have in Hong Kong maybe is another form of a color revolution. And yet there's a color revolution going on right now in Beijing too. It's called red. Mm-hmm. That is an almost, at least from many perspectives, some aspects of neo-Maoist rhetoric at the highest positions of leadership that cannot be gauged to make this problem easier to solve.
Yes, I think that's true. I mean, one of the things I've noticed in Hong Kong is that there's different responses to the mainlanders coming in. In part, yes, there's a new elite clearly coming in. But then you see other reports in the press, which, you know, coming from England, I remember when, you know, people were coming from Eastern Europe, you know, they're taking some of our jobs, they're the plumbers, they're the this, they're the that, they're using our welfare state. And so you've seen some of these tensions reflected within Hong Kong about, well, they're coming down to deliver their babies here, you know, using our welfare facilities. Is this playing to it at all, Heather? This sort of, you know, the friction that Bill is talking about, accommodating different cultures?
So I can't deny that the friction between Hong Kongers and mainlanders is, you know, funnels some of the fuel. That being said, I think it is important for people to understand that the protests are not an anti-mainland protest, and they're not for anti-mainlander protest. Also, the cultural differences between, you know, Polish plumbers versus the mainlanders coming in is that I think a lot of Hong Kongers do feel a sense of existential threat. You know, there are mainlanders from all classes and all kinds of terrible stereotyping. You know, it's really not okay, and Hong Kongers really do need to be better about the way we talk about mainlanders and the way that we treat them. That is definitely true. But I think the sense of existential threat just makes things a little bit, you know, scarier. Mm. I saw that in the last Hong Kong government report, 40 million mainlanders move through Hong Kong every year. Oof. That's a city of 7 million residents, and that's 40 million. So you can see why people get a little bit on edge about it.
Sure. I'm sorry if there are any Polish plumbers in the audience. I don't mean to offend you, but yes, I think the other thing is that the direction that Beijing is moving certainly wouldn't lead to wishes to, you know, accommodate what the protesters are talking about. I mean, I think we're seeing with General Secretary Xi Jinping a very confident leader, someone who clearly feels that, you know, this is his right to rule this, is actually proud of his history, has revived certain aspects of it. It's not just the red culture, as you know, he's reviving study also of Chinese classics. Great. And so I think there is a deeper search also going on in Beijing about, you know, how to provide legitimacy, how to draw lines of continuity with the past. And I think for Xi Jinping, this is just an irritating interruption. You know, when he wants to get on with other business, suddenly this is sort of, you know, taking up time in Politburo meetings and others.
The question then is, if one looks at, I think, talking about the opportunities that Beijing has, an opportunity really for statesmanship and leadership,
yeah,
to take the opportunity, not to make a massive, and this won't happen, I agree with you, a large public concession, but to take at the proper moment a step back and reconsider what is the makeup of the nominating committee, how is the nominating committee chosen. This is all within Beijing's capacity to do in consultation with the Hong Kong government and in consultation with the Hong Kong government that is believed to be representing in part Hong Kong's interests. And I think one of the tensions we have now is that many people in Hong Kong do not believe that the Hong Kong government is representing the interests of Hong Kong as well as it might.
Yeah.
But the question then beyond that would be, it would take a confident, and perhaps President Xi is that confident leader, to take that step. Right now, one could argue just as well, it seems a matter of potential insecurity not to allow Hong Kong to have the level of choice, have a reasonably democratically selected nominating committee to go on to the next steps. We shall see.
Yeah, a president might take that step, a general secretary might not. I want to open it up to questions, but just before that, I have one last question for CM, where we're talking about these different interpretations. We talked about culture. Is there also an issue here that there's different understandings in Beijing and Hong Kong about what law means and the rule of law? I mean, we have had the fourth plenum of the Central Committee in Beijing, which was dedicated to rule of law,
yep.
doesn't look an awful lot like the way that maybe the Lawyers Society might understand law in Hong Kong. Is this also an issue?
I think the basic law we talk about, the Constitution, is a very broad brush approach. You know, you talk about general things. So basically, leave it to local legislation to actually talk about the actual how to implement all these steps. But coming back to the point, I think you're absolutely right. There's actually a very bad expectation management there. Mm. If in Beijing's eyes, you know, like I mentioned in the beginning, the Joint Declaration and the Basic Law always said that the central government has the ultimate authority to appoint the chief executive. If this is the message, why is it not passed it through, you know, after handover 17 years?
Yeah.
You know, expectation management, I think it's bad. You know, and also about Occupy Central, you know, this movement actually was first raised 2 years ago, and Hong Kong government still handled it quite badly, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they fired 87 the tear gas canister on the first day to label all these students as rioters. You know, again, you know, the implementation on the Hong Kong government side, the expectation management from the central government side could be improved, definitely. You know, otherwise, we wouldn't be come to this this stage.
Thanks very much. I'd like to open it up now to the floor. As usual, we have the normal rules for a forum session. First of all, I would ask those of you who are asking questions, please, to identify yourselves. Let us know who you are. And we would like one brief question per person. This is not particularly a place to start with speeches. And also remember that questions do end with a question mark. They don't end with a statement. And last, let me just also add in, if there is one particular person you would like to address your question to, please let us know who that is. We have four stationary mics here, two down here, two up above, and please line up if you have a question that you would like to ask. Please, let's start here.
Jane Mansbridge, I'm a faculty member here at the Kennedy School. And this is addressed to all four of you, can any of you think of a composition of the nominating committee that would be acceptable both to Beijing and to the students? I assume not, but possibly. I mean, then that's what I'm asking you to exercise your imagination. And then the sort of second question is, if there is no such beast available, what do you think, what are the possible outcomes to the present protest?
Thank you. I mean, I think that there probably is actually a composition of the committee that would be acceptable to all parties. A lot then depends on Beijing's wisdom, and going back to Bill's point, you know, would General Secretary Xi be willing to allow that?
Could you specify the kind of...
I'll leave that difficult bit to my panelists. Because I think whatever the composition is, whoever's going to come out elected in this is still going to be favorable to Beijing. So I think they can give in the nominating committee to allow more people from different sectors of society, from labor groups and student groups, to come into the nominating committee. I think there can even be candidates nominated who are in the Democratic camp. I think that would be perfectly acceptable, not beyond the realm of reason. And I still think Beijing would come out on top of that. But other colleagues, I'm sure, might have Heather or CM.
I mean, so I think a little bit of context. The current nominating committee, like the body that votes for the chief executive, consists of 1,200 people. They are selected from like four large sectors of society. The problem is they're not very representative of members of society. So I can't remember the titles of all four of them, but they're like professionals, like real estate. But one of them is literally labor, social service, and religion. And that means basically everyone else in Hong Kong. So you have three of the sectors represent.
No plumbers.
Yeah, no plumbers, no Polish plumbers. So you have three sectors that represent, you know, the elite, and you have one quarter that represents everyone else in Hong Kong. Now, obviously, there's a lot of finesse to where exactly China and the Hong Kong protesters would agree. But even if they took that quarter bracket and they expanded it, even slightly more considerably than it is now, even that would be so much better than the current system that's in place.
And do you think something like that would be acceptable to the students?
Sorry.
I would say Heather, that what
well,
is...
Let Heather just
yeah, please.
On that.
Won't you, please. Would that
oh, no.
be acceptable to students?
Like I said, I think most people who are part of the democracy movement would appreciate any concession. I think, again, like that concession would mean a lot more to the students than it would mean to the Hong Kong government and the Chinese government. But of course, like I said, the democracy movement is really disparate, so it would please some, but not all.
Sorry to cut you off, Bill.
No, not at all. I would just say that it's from a distance, and of course we are looking at this from a great distance here. It ought to be, in my view, in Beijing's interest to ensure that the next chief executive have a strong political base. Mm. And this is one way to have it, to have a nominating committee that has political legitimacy. So what would that be?
The most difficult question lands on my lap. I, to be honest, I'm quite pessimistic, to be honest, to find a solution which is acceptable to the students and also Beijing. Very difficult. Basically, the students are saying that, okay, if there is a nominating committee, it should be directly elected. Everybody can vote for that. For now, like Heather said, the nominating committee will be voted by roughly about 200,000 people from Hong Kong, 7 million. So it's really, really a narrowly elected committee. To be honest, seriously, I don't see any compromise on this particular point. But my personal aim is make this nominating